All right, let's get started. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm guessing probably everyone here is a big fan of SVG. If you're not, you should be. You should spend some time with it. So SVGs, like the things I really like about SVG are that it lets you have high quality rendering at any size. It's got like really easy animation. But best of all, there's a text description behind the scenes that you can edit by hand. And all this is possible because SVG is based on geometric primitives, which is really great for creating outlines. But what if you want to create natural looking fills, like what we have on the capsicum here? So linear, radial gradients, patterns, you can't really do that. You could with bitmap fills, but then you lose the scalability. So how can we solve this? So one solution, one obvious solution, I guess, is to describe the object in full 3D. But doing that, you drastically increase the amount of data that you need to describe the object. So also the amount of time to create it increases, and you lose the ability to edit the text description. So what we need is basically a new type of fill that gives you photorealistic sort of effects, but also just gives you more control in your gradients in general. And so these gradients do exist. There's two types up here. So in SVG 2, we're going to have Kuhn's patch mesh gradients. So we're sort of already on the path to this. Mesh gradients in general are sort of a step between the 3D object and the outline. So you start with your outline and then you subdivide the shape up. You set colours at all the control points within the shape, and the interpolation of the colours within the mesh patches gives you your gradient. So with mesh gradients, you could definitely create this image. And a strong advantage of Kuhn's patch mesh gradients is that they render relatively quickly. But the only problem is that the SVG code to create them can be quite verbose. There's many control points, and this can make animation difficult. So another option is diffusion curves. So diffusion curves give you similar visual results to mesh-based gradients, but they're sort of a higher level representation. So the curves are very strongly tied to the image features. So that makes them quite easy to author and keeps the representation compact. But because of this flexibility, they've traditionally been quite slow to render. Or if you've had a fast renderer, you've made too many quality trade-offs to achieve that. But not anymore. But before I go on, I'm going to introduce myself. So to help me do that, I've distilled the entire essence of myself into this slide. So my name is Nikos. I'm a software engineer. I work at CISRA in Sydney. CISRA is short for Canon Information Systems Research Australia. And we're one of Canon's overseas R&D centres. So one of my roles at CISRA is to represent Canon on the SVG working group. And the good thing about that is we are researching diffusion curves at CISRA, and I think that diffusion curves are a perfect fit for SVG. So over the next 20, 25 minutes or so, I'm going to explain to you why that is, and also demonstrate to you. So this is my second talk at the Graphical Web on diffusion curves. So last year, my talk was more general. I talked about sort of the state of the art and gave an overview of the published papers. But I ended my talk last year by saying that in the future, I hope to be giving a talk on how you can actually use diffusion curves in SVG. But we are still a way off that. But what I'm going to talk about today actually brings us a lot closer than I thought we would be by this point. So I'm pretty excited by that. So my plan to talk today is I'm going to talk about a model for including diffusion curves in SVG that's quite general and it fits in with the capabilities of the most recently published renderers. I'll demonstrate our new renderer, which is very fast and it maintains high quality. And I'll also talk about how the model can allow for specification of and render both diffusion curve gradients and mesh-based gradients. But first, I'll quickly explain what diffusion curves are. So diffusion curves are a vector drawing primitive for specifying complex colour gradients. So curves are used because they map very well to image features, but the constraints are really just points. So a diffusion curve is just a continuous chain of these constraints. So a constraint could be anything, but for an image, it's probably colour. And what the constraint does is it fixes a value at a position, so on the curve, and then the colours between the curves are calculated by looking at the influence of all the other constraints in the image. So the example here gives you an idea of how compact the representation is. So we just need two extra pieces of information, the colour on the left and the colour on the right-hand side of the curve, to generate this gradient image. So you can see how, as the colour moves out away from the curve, it mixes. So that's the result with a single curve. If you add many curves, you can create a much more complex image, such as this car. So, but you can see that beyond sort of the basic curves that you need to define the shape of the car, there's very few extra curves that you need to define the fill. So now I'd like to show you a gallery of diffusion curve images. So show you an idea of what diffusion curves are capable of. So some of these, some of you might have seen before. These were all created by CISRA. But some of these might be new. So these images were rendered with our renderer, but using diffusion curve data that was created by an organisation called INRIA in France. So I want to thank them for allowing me to show these images to you. So many of these images were created by automatically vectorising photographs. But some are hand-drawn, and they have a tool that allows you to sample the colours from a backing photo as you draw. And I guess the important thing to remember with these images is that they are all scalable. So they're all complex diffusion curve images, so where the images are created entirely with diffusion curves. But in SVG, we have a lot of other primitives and graphics primitives and fills, so we can use those in a complementary manner with diffusion curves. So my expectation is that, for example, when you've made this car in SVG, for example, you would only use diffusion curves for some of the sections, some of the segments, and you could use other fills elsewhere. So I sort of think that in SVG, we'll move away from the entire diffusion curve image, as we've sort of seen in all the published papers so far, and instead we'll define a diffusion curve patch that can be used within an image as a fill. So I think it's kind of useful to look at some of the more basic effects that you can achieve. So conical gradients are very easy. You just define a spoke for each colour transition. You can create tubey type things with highlights that run along the shape of the object. And sort of any texture that you create will of course be scalable. So you need not diffuse a full colour image. You could just diffuse a single channel and apply that to another object via blending to create sort of lighting effects and light maps. And I think diffusion curves will probably be really good for filling in text, and so it would be quite good in SVG and OpenType. So my primary purpose today in giving this talk is basically spread the word on diffusion curves and let you know about our efforts to come up with a proposal for a way of integrating diffusion curves into SVG. So there's a lot of technical work to be done. We need to be able to prove that diffusion curves can fit into SVG and offer the performance that would be needed. But there's also an equal amount of work to specify how an author would control diffusion curves and how we would meet the needs of authors. So hopefully the examples I've shown might be inspirational to you and start you thinking about how you would use diffusion curves in your content. And if so, I would really love to hear some feedback from you and talk about your ideas, and so I can make sure that any model I propose will meet those needs. So at CISRA we have a lot of diffusion curve images, simple and basic, and I imagine other organisations do as well. So if we are to standardise diffusion curves, I'd like to make that data all available to people as soon as possible. It could then be used for demonstrating diffusion curves, for benchmarking and comparing renderers, and it could later be converted into proper tests. So the important thing though is that all this is under a licence that is supportive of all that. Now I'm going to go into the next part of my talk where I talk about a sort of proposal for how we might specify some syntax for SVG. So I've started working on drafting a proposal, but I do want to stress that this is pretty much unofficial at this point. I'm a member of the working group, but this hasn't been discussed in detail with the working group yet. We haven't got their approval. In the near future, I will publish a draft proposal though, for the working group and for anyone else who's interested to start looking at. Basically, so far I've written up a sort of high-level syntax and a description of the model that the syntax specifies. So there's a lot to do still, but I would like to get comments on it as early as possible. So the model I think that we should follow keeps diffusion curve gradients fairly close to linear and radial gradients in terms of their specification and use. So this means that diffusion curves would be a fill rather than a geometry. And I've gone in this direction because I want to keep them as simple as possible, both from an implementation perspective, as well as for authors to fit in with their sort of current understanding of SVG. So I've defined what I call a diffusion curve patch. And each of these can be used as a fill. And a diffusion curve patch consists of a boundary curve and then zero or more inner diffusion curves that define the colour transition within the patch. So the boundary curve allows constraints to be set around the edge of a patch. The boundary isn't necessarily required for the maths, but different solving techniques might give different results when diffusing out to infinity. So if we define a boundary curve, it helps keep things consistent. So to define one of these patches, we have what a DC patch element. And this lives inside the defs element. It's referenced by ID from the shape being filled, just like any other paint server. And so we have a boundary colour, which is white, and nothing inside. So this will just create you a white rectangle. But you don't use diffusion curves to get solid white fills. So to give something more interesting, we can set many colour constraints along the boundary. So here we're setting various colours on the corners of the boundary. And so this will give you a gradient that's kind of similar to what you would get if you specified a mesh with those colours at the four control points. So if it's a little bit difficult to imagine this from just looking at that, don't worry, I do have a demo coming up. But first, I just want to talk about the constraints some more. So a constraint is a value that's fixed at a particular position. I've already said that. So in SVG, the constraint is colour. But gradients usually use the term colour stop. So we're going to use that as well. In a diffusion curve patch, a colour stop is a colour constraint that's specified by an author at a particular point on a diffusion curve. So the stop specifies the colour on either the left or on the right or on both sides of the curve. And then between the stops, along the length of the curve, you get a sort of a smooth transition of colour. You can also get a sharp transition if you specify two stops at one point, in the same way that you can with linear gradients. So defining a diffusion curve within the patch is done by this DC path element. So this is very similar to the existing path element. It has a D attribute, which sets the path data, and that follows the standard syntax. And then to set the stops, we have this color profile attribute. So this allows us to set many stops in a very compact sort of way. There is also a DC stop element, but I'll get to that a bit later. So now the fun bit, time to fire up a demo, and I'll show you some examples. So this is DC fiddle. So going to sort of the basic example that I had before. Hang on a sec. Don't want my... Ah, shit. Sorry. All right. So if we specify four colours on the boundary, we get this nice patch across there. So if we add a DC path element, we can specify a colour on that that diffuses outwards on both sides of the patch. Oh, sorry, I forgot we don't actually support named colours yet. All right, so we get a line that diffuses white out on both sides. So now we might want to set a different colour on the other side. Or actually, no, we'll set a colour at the end of the path. So you can see that you get sort of this smooth transition along the direction of the path, or along the length of the path, sorry. And now we might want to specify a colour on the other side of the path, or on the right-hand side of the path. So that way you get sort of a sharp transition across the path. So if we change the path data, we sort of get that. But then if we close it, you can see that the color on the inside doesn't mix with the color on the outside. So that creates sort of two isolated regions. So hopefully that gives you kind of an example of how it works. You could sort of add a hell of a lot more SVG in there, and you get the full image. All right, so there are some features of the color profile that I didn't use in my example. So you can set a position relative to either like the full path length, just a segment of the path, or a subpath. It's also possible to specify two colors at one stop, as I already mentioned. But it's probably best to wait for the proposal to come out before we look at the grammar too closely. So the color profile attribute is really good because it's really powerful, but it's also very compact. But command strings in SVG can have some drawbacks. So for example, when you're animating. So I think it might also be useful to include a DC stop element that lets you specify stops using an element-based syntax. So if you have two stops in the same position, one specified on a DC stop and one in the color profile, then the DC stop will override the color profile. And this is kind of nice because it means you can have a long color profile and keep that relatively compact, but any particular point that you might want to animate, you only need to specify with a DC stop. So it gives you kind of a nice mix of compactness and ease of use for the author. So we've already talked about the boundary curves, and I've shown you the basic case where a boundary is a rectangle that just encloses the view box of the DC path. But there's also a second option for the boundary, so where it can be inherited from the shape that's being filled. So this means that the boundary shape for the diffusion curve patch matches the boundary shape of the element that's being filled. And that boundary colour, those boundary colour constraints map then onto this new boundary. So this is very useful for reusing patches, but it also lets you define a mesh-like structure using this syntax. So this is an example. So we've got a star created with sort of a polygon element. Obviously, SVG doesn't have a star element. And we filled it with this diffusion curve patch. So I probably thought you probably wouldn't be able to read this SVG, but on this screen size, you probably can. But really, I just included it here to show you the compactness of the representation. So it's only 23 lines of what's pretty readable SVG, which I think is quite impressive. So, but here's a visual representation of that file. So we have the polygon star, which is in the def, which is in the SVG. We have a DC patch within the def's element that has five diffusion curve paths to generate the large spokes and five for the short spokes. So if we render just that patch, ignoring the inherent value in the star, we get sort of this square diffusion curve patch. We would also get this result if we filled a rectangle with this. But then when we inherit the boundary from the star, you can see that the colour stops from the boundary are then mapped onto the boundary of the star. So the boundary shape of the patch is kind of basically being morphed into this star shape. So, and that lets you define, being able to do that kind of lets you define a mesh using this syntax. The only thing this is really missing, I guess, is shared path segments. But that may end up in SVG 2, which would be really good. So now I'm going to, for those with a technical interest, give a quick rundown of how our new renderer works and why it's quite fast. So in 2013 at SIGGRAPH, CISRA published this paper titled Biharmonic Diffusion Curve Images from Boundary Elements. So in this paper, we describe a boundary element renderer that's very, very accurate, and it's totally free from artifacts. The downside of this renderer is that it's quite slow. It's too slow to be used in sort of a real-time platform like the web. But having said that, it's an excellent benchmark for assessing quality and just for helping our understanding. And so we did learn a lot from implementing this renderer. So these lessons let us go back to an older renderer that we had that was already very fast, but which suffered from quality issues, and helped us fix those. So, and that's the renderer that I'm going to talk about today. So the model that we implement and that is used in the SVG proposal that I've talked about is called the biharmonic diffusion curves model. So this model is also compatible with INRIA's paper, their vectorial solver. So the biharmonic model is general purpose, it's well defined, and it incorporates the most useful controls for authors. So in the biharmonic model, colours are specified on the left and the right of the curves, and you can also specify a gradient control on the left and the right of each curve. So setting the gradient allows the author to control the colour fall-off as the colour diffuses outwards. And setting the same gradient on both sides is very nice because that gives you a smooth transition across, across the boundary. So our renderer is based on the multigrid method. So this is an approach that has been used in quite a few papers, and that's because it's pretty much the fastest way to solve this type of problem. So the multigrid method, it's basically an iterative approach to solving differential equations. So it's an approximation of the actual result, but it is close enough to be considered visually correct, I think. So in our renderer, we've managed to achieve a 10 times speed up over other published methods, and we've also solved a lot of the leakage, or all the leakage issues that has plagued other renderers. So leakage basically is when colour from one side of a curve mixes with colour on the other side of the curve, when it shouldn't. So this is an extreme example that I kind of just made up to show you guys. In the real world it's usually more subtle, but it's definitely very noticeable. So in a multigrid render, it's typically caused by holes in the data there, or when many line segments end or cross one pixel. So we take a number of steps to avoid leakage, but what we essentially do is we thicken the rendered constraints, and to do that we look at like the curve data at a subpixel level, rather than just relying on the rendered pixels. So there's four steps to a multi-grid renderer. They're fairly common to renderers of this type, but we do some additional processing at each step to improve the quality. So first we start with a diffusion curve image, which is SVG paths with colour stops. So the paths are rendered to form this constraint image. So firstly, the diffusion curves themselves are rendered. So the colour value for the rendered diffusion curve is the result of compositing the colours from the left and of the right-hand side of the path. And then we also anti-alias based on subpixel coverage. And then we track around these rendered paths. So we add additional boundary pixels so that the curve pixels are entirely enclosed. So the boundary constraint pixels are sort of the first step to avoiding the leakage problem. So the value for the boundary pixels is based on the closest path in all the eight directions around the pixel. So at this point we have three types of pixel in the image. We have our curve constraint pixels, which are the diffusion curves. We have our boundary constraint pixels, which surround the diffusion curves. And then we have all these other unconstrained pixels. And so they don't have any value set, and they're going to be the ones that are going to hold the diffuse colour at the end. So then we begin, we downsample the image and we thicken. So the thickening actually comes first, but for each unconstrained pixel, basically we set the colour to the average of its constrained neighbours. So that kind of means that the colour diffuses outwards. So that's not the final diffused colour, but it's a seed for the diffusion process later. So after we do that, then we check to see if there are still some unconstrained pixels, and if there are, then we downsample again. So we quarter the buffer size at each step, and we repeat the thickening and then check for the unconstrained pixels and downsample again, and we keep going all the way down until we don't have any more unconstrained pixels. So at that point we've finished our downsampling. So then we start to upsample and we smooth. So we step back up through those same buffers that we used before. Any unconstrained pixels are coloured from the colour value from the buffer below. And then to diffuse, we apply a number of smoothing passes. So again, we repeat that process at each level. And again, and again. And then when we've filled and we've smoothed the original pixel constraint image, we're finished. So it might seem like a lot of steps, but the whole process is actually pretty quick. So how quick? So for this car at 512 by 512, it takes 40 milliseconds. And in fact, any 512 by 512 image takes about the same amount of time, because the time is constrained by the size of the final image rather than the complexity of the curve data. So the process of rendering the curves and doing the thickening is pretty much negligible. So these performance figures are on oldish hardware. It's sort of, I think it's a last generation i5, 2.6 gigahertz. It's all single-threaded currently, and we don't use any hardware acceleration. So this is basically just our proof of concept without any optimizations yet. So we think we can still make some pretty big performance improvements. I'll be bold and I'll say I think we can double the speed. How about the quality? So the visual result, this is a comparison of our boundary element renderer to our multi-grid renderer. So the renderings aren't identical. There are some small differences, but they're not really obvious. And I would say that the quality is comparable. So how about the code? So diffusion curve renderers are sort of known to be very complex. And depending on the solving approach that you take, that can be true. But the multi-grid method isn't hugely complex. 3,000 lines to sort of prepare the multi-grid, and that includes parsing and writing bitmaps and timing and everything. And then it's about another 500 lines for the multi-grid solver. So that doesn't seem to me to be too complex. And that actually brings me to the end of my talk. So the results that we've achieved, I think, have given me really good confidence that diffusion curves can work in SVG. The performance and the quality of the RAW render is pretty good. And writing up the syntax proposal has sort of really shown me that this is a feature that would be really nice for authors. So my plan, I guess, is to push ahead and propose a diffusion curves module for SVG for some time after SVG 2. And at CISRA, our sort of next steps, I think, so we'd like to improve our renderer further and perhaps port it into WebKit to give a real proof of concept. We need to flesh out the proposal some more. And we want to set up this diffusion curve image repository that I talked about. So I'd love to talk to you, any of you who are interested about this, some more. As I said, this is sort of for me to tell you what we're doing and to find out who's interested and get feedback about how you would use this. It's really good to be able to talk to sort of artists and designers about this sort of thing. So that's the end. Thank you.
Any questions?
Dirk.
You had some examples at the beginning where you had code examples that you changed by and saw the results. Mm. Was it then server side or in JavaScript?
Not done in JavaScript. No, it's done. It's an application. So I have like a node script that the SVG gets sent to, and that writes out the SVG file and runs.
Would it still be possible that you can create a server that people can reference and actually use?
It would be nice
to do that, set that up publicly so that people can experiment. But I don't know if that's something that I'll be able to do anytime soon. But I think it would be a really cool thing to have.
But there are JavaScript renderers for images.
There are, yeah. Yeah, and they're not sort of, you can't type in your own data and see what you get. So.
More questions?
So in this presentation you mostly touched on, actual diffusion curves. But in the original proposal, let's say, they were combined with also spatially varying blur, which for a lot of artistic purposes, it is quite important. So how do you see this?
I'd like to see the blur as a separate thing, maybe like a filter effect or something. I think once you've got the gradient controls, that gives you sort of nice additional controls. It doesn't give you exactly what the blur gives you. But yeah, I mean, my thoughts are probably that the blur should be a separate step later. Yeah.
The session is almost about animations.
Yes, right? Yes, and
so
I'm like...
What about animations and diffusion curves?
Well, they're animatable. That's one of the advantages, I think, of diffusion curves over mesh gradients is...
But do you envisage more... this is like a paint server, right?
Yes.
So would you animate the object that's using the diffusion curve and therefore add more, or animating the point of the diffusion
there's no reason. The only consideration there, I think, would be performance mostly. Depending on how you created your diffusion curve and were you using your diffusion curve, if you created sort of one big patch and were only filling part of your image with that because you had a transform on the patch, for example, then you wouldn't need to recalculate.
And what about the stability of the rendering?
As in quality-wise, you mean?
Yeah, if you decide to rotate your...
It's been good from the experiments I've done so far.
So, but even 1K to 1K is not very big, actually. Mm. Especially with retina displays, I mean, we have to make better quality, is that an issue?
No, I think if once we get some more speed-ups, I think, I mean, 512 by 512 at 40 milliseconds is pretty good.
But is the idea that, if I understand correctly, the proposal is diffusion curves as a texture? So
that's right. So you...
A diffusion curve that fills the whole screen, or...
Well, you might, but...
You might, but it's, it might not be the...
It's... I mean, it's generally, yeah, it's like a one-off cost initially. And then, yeah.
Do you have any more quantitative data on the quality? Because I was a little bit worried about the fact that I could already see the differences. Because
between the two renderers?
Diffusion curves tend to hide the errors, basically, because they're so smooth and our eyes simply don't pick up the difference.
I haven't sort of, don't have any more than what I've shown you. But the renderer was only quite recently finished, so we are going to spend more time. But I think you will sort of get different results with different renderers, though, because, I mean, particularly with something like, well, for something like multigrid, where it's sort of an approximation, because you're just applying smoothing between the constraints. And
So that's a follow-up question. What's the level of interoperability you would like to have?
Well, I think the important thing, I guess, is to maintain the author's settings at the curves. I think at the constraints, you have to have the right value there. But I think as long as you're getting sort of a correct profile between your constraints, then I think that would be... Because, I mean, as you see, like, they're different renderers, but there's... If they weren't next to each other, you wouldn't see...
So what would you think about something like, for example, natural neighbor interpolation, which in many ways is kind of a first-order approximation, but much more explicit?
I don't really understand the question.
So, I mean, diffusion curves are really nice. I mean, conceptually, you can do a lot of stuff with them, and they're nice. But, I mean, there are some inherent problems in really generating high-quality renders where you can really say, okay, this is reproducible, If I'm going to see this image, this other person I'm sending it to will see the exact same image.
Yeah.
We've also seen some performance issues. Maybe we'll get faster renders, maybe we won't, but it's an issue. So what about alternatives, so things that look similar, have similar functionality, but maybe a more explicit definition. So the one I know of is natural neighbor coordinates, but there might be many. It's basically that you build a Voronoi diagram, and you input a point, and you basically get a weighted...
That's the basis of the Jeschke's method. That's the initialization of the...
I mean, I think with SVG, I mean, one of the things I really like about SVG is that it's text, you can edit it, it's not overly verbose. So I think that's why diffusion curves are probably a very nice fit.
Yeah, okay, but I mean, presumably you would be able to do more or less the same kind of stuff with such an alternative, but...
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the thing, like the SVG, we need to look at this, I want to get discussion started. I want to look at this over the next sort of year or two, I think it would be good to consider more other alternatives and look at what's available.
Some more time for more questions if you want. Just one more question.
Mm-hmm.
We had an authoring tool in the previous talk.
Yes.
So what would an authoring tool for diffusion curves look like?
This is an interesting question.
The SVG representations has to be somehow a trade-off between something easy to render but also something easy to generate.
Mm.
Have you started doing experiments?
No, we haven't really done a lot of experiments with... I mean, the traditional method,
when
I guess,
you
is...
You author them by hand, that's already an experiment, but
Yeah, but sort of the UI or the graphical is generally you have the curves and you have a little control point for the colors that you can add to. I don't know if that's, there hasn't been, doesn't seem like there's been a lot of consideration for other alternatives for specifying, for using a UI. So I think that's something that would be looked at.
Okay, let's thank our speaker. Cool.